I look back at those pictures and you see the smiles on these people's faces, and they became part of the success story.
It's the country they live in. They live in amazing country. It's very different from a biologist perspective than anywhere else in the country.
The volunteers, whether it was in Arizona with the Goulds or any of the other states around the country, when we were able to be showing the expansion of turkey populations, the volunteers kind of came with that because they saw that opportunity.
The habitat diversity situation that we have in southeast Arizona. We have these mountain ranges that rise up sort of like islands in the sea of the desert, so they call them sky islands.
The Goulds, not only here in the Huachucas, but in all the sky islands, they're utilizing major riparian corridors, and they're moving up and down laterally within those. That's where we have our water on the side slopes, we have our roost trees. These Goulds turkey will roost in oak trees along the sides, pines, cottonwoods, sycamores. They really utilize these travel corridors up and down from the top of the mountain all the way down into the low area, almost approaching Mexico. Each individual one of these major canyons, they have sort of a population unto itself. So it's more like a microhabitat.
Typically, when you go from north to south, it's called Bergman's Rule. Whether it's deer or turkeys, they're going to have smaller body size the further south you go because of the mass of the individual and surface area allows for heat loss. So the fact that Goulds came from Mexico and then southern Arizona and being the size that they are kind of defies the rules that you would normally have in wildlife. So they're a very unique bird, and that classic white tail tips and what you got are very distinctive in the Goulds. When they started out with the Goulds project, that's kind of how I got involved in the 80s, trying to help with the reintroduction. So we work with the Mexican government about bringing turkeys from Mexico into Arizona. They were mandating that they had to be held in a turkey facility for 30 days to make sure they didn't carry any diseases. The opportunity was going to be, how are we going to be able to get around this quarantine standpoint? Ron Engel Wilson, who was the turkey project leader, we had agreed that we would bring turkeys across the border. We would put radio transmitters on them. The government would allow us to turn them loose, getting through all of the red tape to make sure the birds were clean, and then bring in something that would have caused an industry issue with poultry.
As their population increased, there was a group of us. We could see that there were some needs with habitat enhancement projects to assist game and fish and the Goulds turkey population. We formally adopted as a chapter in 1999. That's when we held our first banquet at that time. Primarily when we first started, it was to get involved in the Goulds turkey restoration efforts, try to go out and develop habitat projects to enhance that population.
It just goes to highlight the passion that all of these folks had. Only a percentage of the people involved were getting paid to do this. Everyone else was a volunteer, and they're putting in, we call that the sweat equity, right? And they're spending all of their time working to make this program happen.
It's not something that you can start with and just drop the ball. We're seeing changing times with recreational hunting pressures, habitat changes. Once you do these things and you make these changes in habitat, you cannot turn around and just walk away and say, we did the change. It needs constant maintenance, but it's one of the most important things if you want something long-term and to see those improvements.
Our Southwest Turkey Management Plan, it says management plan, but what it is a description of what's happened, where we're at now, and where we want to go forward. Well, that's a little bit outdated, so it's time for us to update that and reassess where we're at and where we want to go moving forward.
When you looked at the Gould's project in Arizona, knowing that this was a very unique subspecies found really in only one part of the state down at Fort Huachuca, and we could expand it to the Sky Mountains and be able to hunt wild turkeys, you know, in other parts of Arizona, this was a big, big deal. And the chapter volunteers rallied to that.
That's one of our better conservation stories, especially in terms of big game. We looked at the problem, you know, we knew the history of what had gone on and attacked it based on the latest science. It worked out. I think it's a great success. I'm glad to have been a small part of that.
That's what walleye management's about, to go in there and continue to look at the habitat and to do what's best for the land and what's best for the wildlife.
For the first 10 years that they're doing this, they're teetering on the edge of failure. And all of the effort and the heartbreak that's going into this, and they stuck with it. They didn't give up.
Nothing happens unless there's cooperation. Nothing. The most important aspect of any of it was cooperation and collaboration between NGOs, private, state, and federal. And in the case of Gould's turkeys, international, because of Mexico's involvement. And opening those boxes and releasing those Gould's turkeys, that's the one thing I'll never forget. That was so great to be a part of.
The history of what's gone into this effort and the reason why we're here now. We stood on the shoulders of giants.